Hello all. In today's session, we are going to talk about the study of microwave components. And I am the presenter, Mrs. S. K. Gaikwad, Assistant Professor, Pimpri Chinchwad College of Engineering, Pune. Now let us start with the typical connection of the microwave bench. Whenever we talk about the microwave bench or microwave practicals, we need to understand what that typical setup is there. And that setup is called as the microwave bench. So here we can see the first component here in the microwave bench is nothing but the microwave source. Here we will talk only about the two sources, the reflex klystron and the gun oscillator. So here, whatever setup we are observing right now, it is the setup with the klystron. So here we are having a klystron mount, and klystron needs a special dedicated power supply, which is called as the klystron power supply. Always the second component will be the isolator, which will protect your source from unmatched load. If any reflections will be there from this side, they will protect your source. Okay, so always your second component will be the isolator. Here we can see attenuator, variable attenuator. If your power requirement is not met, you can attenuate your power here with this particular attenuator. Third one is, you can say the fourth one is nothing but the frequency meter. As we are talking about the frequencies which are in the gigahertz, in the X band, we talk about the frequencies which are 8 gigahertz to 12 gigahertz, not directly measured on the CRO, as we know that our CRO range doesn't cover the gigahertz frequency. So this is the frequency meter, which will help you to measure the microwave frequencies. Next one is nothing but the slotted line with the probe carriage, whereas we can see actual maximas and minimas. The last one is nothing but the detector mount. As we know that we are not able to measure the microwave frequencies directly on the CRO, we are using any modulating signal, either a square wave signal. Here typically we are using the square wave as a modulating signal. We are using our microwaves as the carrier, and we are modulating that particular signal. Modulated wave will be given to this particular components, and at the end where we are observing the signal, we are demodulating that particular square wave and we are giving it to the CRO, otherwise to the VSWR meter. So this is the typical connection of the microwave bench with the klystron, you can say, mount. The next one is nothing but the typical connection of the microwave bench where we are using or we are changing the source. Here you can see your source is changed from klystron to the gun oscillator. So this is the gun oscillator, this is the pin modulator, whereas actual modulation process takes place. Then the frequency meter, you can see the rest of the circuitry or rest of the components are same as we have seen previously. Here the only change is that if you're going for the gun oscillator, you need a gun power supply with the pin bias also. Okay, so here also you need to use an isolator, which is not used in this bench, but it is always recommended that you should use an isolator after source. As we know that if we are comparing the reflex klystron and the mic, you can say the gun oscillator generates a very low power as compared to the reflex klystron. That's why you can say the isolator is optional, but it is always recommended that you should use the isolator. The next one is nothing but now we are going to study each and every component step by step. So the reflex klystron, so here you can see this is nothing but the how your reflex klystron looks like. So this is a simple waveguide on which you can see this cavity is mounted. So klystron is a microwave generator that works on the reflections and oscillations in the single cavity, which has a variable frequency. So reflex klystron contains an electron gun, a cathode filament, an anode cavity, and an electrode at the cathode potential. So it offers a low power and has low competence. Next one is nothing but the gun oscillator. So this is how your gun oscillator looks like. So it was invented by John Gunn in 1960s. After his experiments on gallium arsenide, he observed a noise in his experiments result and owed this to the generation of electrical oscillations at microwave frequencies by a steady electric field with a magnitude greater than a threshold value. So it was named as a Gunn effect. After this has been discovered by John Gunn. So as this is discovered by Gunn, the name is given as the Gunn oscillator. Now next component is nothing but the isolator. This is nothing but the how isolator looks like. An isolator is a two-port device, whereas we are observing one port here and another port will be here. So that transmits microwave or radio frequency power in one direction only. It will allow in this direction only. In the opposite direction, it will attenuate the power. So it is used to shield the equipment on its input side from the effects of condition on its output side. So for example, to prevent a microwave source being detuned by the mismatch load, always that this will not be the condition that you are terminating your circuit with the match termination. It may happen that your termination is unmatched. In that case, reflections will be there and it may detune your oscillator, and that's why always it is recommended that you should isolate it immediately after the source. The next component is nothing but the variable attenuators. So here you can see how it looks like. So this is the image of variable attenuator. So the attenuators are basically passive devices which control power levels in the microwave system by absorption of the signal. So attenuator which attenuates the RF signal in the waveguide system is referred as the waveguide attenuator. So here you can see here, this is nothing but a waveguide variable type attenuator. So this figure depicts waveguide based fixed type attenuator. There are two types of the attenuator. One is the fixed type attenuator and other one is the variable attenuator. So in the variable attenuator, you'll find this kind of the plunger, whereas you can set the attenuation kind of thing. So here thin dielectric strip with coated resistive film is placed at the center of the waveguide. So film is placed in the waveguide parallel to the maximum A field. So as the resistive film is placed at the center and it is fixed, you can say this will be the fixed type attenuator. Now next one is nothing but the variable type waveguide attenuator. So resistive vane is moved from one side of the wall, whereas you can see in this particular figure, this is the variable type attenuator. You can move this particular film, vane is moved from one side of the wall to the center by using screw, where E field is considered to be a maximum. So this resistive film is shaped to give a linear attenuation variations. Next one is nothing but the frequency meter. As we know that we are not at all able to see the gigahertz frequencies on the CRO, we are using this direct frequency meter. So that it will give you the direct reading, whereas you'll observe the horizontal markers and one vertical marker will be there. Okay. So the frequency meter used have a cavity which is coupled to a waveguide by a small coupling hole, which is used to absorb only a tiny fraction of energy passing along the waveguide. So adjusting the micrometer of the frequency meter will vary the plunger into the cavity. This will alter the cavity size and hence resonance frequency. So the reading on the micrometer scales are calibrated against frequency. So you can see the readings over here which are calibrated against the frequency. So as the plunger enters the cavity, it's seized or its size is reduced and the frequency increases. Now here the wave meter is adjusted for the maximum or minimum power meter readings depending on whether the cavity is a transmission or absorption type device. So with the transmission type device, the power meter will be adjusted for a maximum. So it only allows the frequency close to the resonance to be transmitted through them. Other frequencies are reflected down the waveguide. The wave meter acts as a short circuit for other frequencies. So only frequency to which it resonates will allow to pass. So for the absorption type wave meter, the power meter will be adjusted for a minimum. So it's absorbed power from the line around resonant frequency and acts as a short to other frequencies. So the absorbing material used to absorb any unwanted signal that will cause the disturbance to the system. So we can see the dip on the CRO, whereas you can see the low power, you can say there will be the resonant frequency. So slotted section with probe carriers. So this is nothing but the how. This is simple waveguide, whereas you have made a slot and in which you are inserting the probe carriage. So in a waveguide, a slot is made at the center of the broadside axially. A movable probe connected to a crystal detector is inserted in the slot of the waveguide. So the output of the crystal detector is proportional to the square of the input voltage applied. So the movable probe permits convenient and accurate measurement at its position. But as the probe is moved along, its output is proportional to the standing wave pattern, so which is formed inside the waveguide. So a variable attenuator is employed here to obtain the accurate results. So here you are able to move this particular one along with this particular line, you are able to see the maximas and minimas. So how we are going to find out the voltage standing wave ratio with the slotted probe carrier? So VSWR is equal to square root of V max by V min, which you are observing on the CR. Next one is nothing but the detector mount, and this is nothing but the last component of your you can see your microwave range. So what actually detect amount does? As we have already discussed, it demodulates your signal. So this is nothing but how it looks like. You are connecting your CRO probe over here to see the signal. So detect amount are used to detect the low frequency signals with the help of IN23 detector diode. So the detector diode is mounted on the broad wall of the waveguide. A shorting plunger is used to tune the maximum power near the detector diode. So this is nothing but the, you can say, the detector mount. Next one is nothing but the T's. Now these are nothing but the microwave components. So we are going to discuss about the three types of the T's. So out of that, the first type is nothing but the E-plane T. This is nothing but the how your E-plane looks like. You can say this is port 1, this is port 2, and this is port 3. Always your collinear ports will be named as a 1 and 2, and auxiliary port is named as a port number 3. So this is nothing but the whenever the E field enters from the port number 1, you can say it will be here. You can say a waveguide T is a 3-port device that is similar to power divided. So when the axis of side arm is parallel to the electric field of the collinear, so you can see here the axis of the side arm, this is the electric field, this will be parallel to the electric field. So then the T's is called as the E-plane T junction. The output we get in this type of the T's are 180 degree out of phase with each other, irrespective of form which port the input is fed. So here, if you are giving it from the port number 3, they will be equally divided into port number 1 and 2, but they will be out of phase. So here always, if you are giving it into the port number 2, again, there will be the 180 degree phase shift in two ports. Next one is nothing but the H-plane T, whereas this is nothing but the how H-plane T looks like. So when the axis of the side arm of the waveguide T, here you can see this is the axis of the side arm is parallel to the flow of the magnetic field from the port 1. So agar yahan pe aapka magnet, if electric field in the port 1 is like this, so your magnetic field will be perpendicular to each other. So here you can see your side arm will be parallel to the magnetic field, and that's why this particular T will be called as the H-plane T. So H-plane waveguide T's can be thought of as a two-way in-phase power divider or combiner. That is, it is additive in nature. When the two input signal are fed from port number 1 and 2, the output at port 3 is in phase and additive. And when the input signal is fed to port 3, the signal is split into two equal parts and are in phase at port 1, 2. If you are giving something to the port 2 equally and in phase, it will be divided into 1 and 2. But in the E-plane T, they were equal but opposite in the phase. Now, next one is nothing but the EH-plane T. This is nothing but how EH-plane T looks like. And this is nothing but the figure of magic T, if you want to draw. So a magic T or a hybrid T is a 4-port waveguide piece that is a combination of E-plane T and H-plane T. So this, you can say, the H-plane T, and this is the E-plane T. So this is the combination of E and H-plane T. So magic T has a 4 ports, port 1 and port 2. These are 2 collinear ports. Port 3 is nothing but a difference port, and port 4 is nothing but the sum port. So operations of the magic T, when two signals of equal magnitude are fed from port 1 and 2, we get a 0 at port 3 and sum of the two signals at port number 4. When the signal is fed through port number 4, it gets divided equally between port 1 and 2, and both the outputs are in phase, but no output will be there from the port number 3. If you are giving, or when a signal is fed through port 3, we get an output of equal magnitude but opposite phase at port 1 and 2. The signals are 180 degrees out of phase. Output at port 4 is 0. So your port number 1 and 2 are in isolation. Your port number 3 and 4 are in isolation. Now circulator. So circulator is a three-port device, 1, 2 and 3. Somewhere you will find their third port. A circulator is a device that transports radio frequency or microwave signal from one port to another. They typically have 3 ports. They are made of magnet and ferrite materials with the magnetic properties. So circulators can be made to circulate clockwise or counterclockwise. So either if it is a clockwise circulator, if you are giving it to the one port 1, it will go to the port 2 and not to the port 3, like that. Okay, that's why it is called as a circulator. So here directional coupler. So what do you mean by the directional coupler? Directional coupler is having a four port device, 1, 2, you can say 3 and a 4. So directional coupler, 1, 2, 3 and a 4. So the properties of an ideal directional coupler are as follows. All the termination are matched to the ports. When the power travels from port 1 to port 2, some portion of it gets coupled to the port 4 but not to the port 3. As it is also a bidirectional coupler, when the power travels from port 2 to port 1, some portion of it gets coupled to port 3 but not to port 4. Okay? So if the power is incident through port 3, a portion of it is coupled to the port 2 but not to the port 1. So if the power is incident through port 4, a portion of it is coupled to port 1 but not to the port 2. So port 1, 3 are decoupled as the port 2 and 4. So ideally the output of the port 3 should be 0. However, practically a small amount of power called back power is observed at port 3. The following figures indicate the power flow in the direction, or you can say power is observed at port 3. So this figure shows you the power flow of, you can say, to the directional coupler. So as there is a small amount of power, ideally it should not be anything there at port number 3, but you will observe some power. That's why it is terminated with the match termination if you're going to use it in the practicals. So this is all about the microwave components. Thank you. We'll stop here.